And now for something completely different.
My name is Scott Toy Guru Knightlick, and like you, I'm a toy collector. And probably like you, I grew up in the 1980s, the time when pop culture reached the pinnacle of pop culture-ness. Ooh, I think I just made up a new word. And I loved toys as a kid. It was a very special time, especially with the deregulation that happened with the media under Reagan administration. Shows like He-Man and shows like Transformers spawned amazing toy lines that just were not possible before the deregulation of the FCC. And I loved all of them. But of all the toy lines out in the 80s, my number one was Star Wars. My parents took me to see the original movie when I was 6 months old, and they said that I just stared at the screen the whole time on their lap. Clearly, I was brainwashed from day one. Well, all that brainwashing paid off because I was very blessed and very fortunate to grow up to actually get to work in the toy industry. And there's not a moment with any of the companies I've worked for that has been nothing but me being grateful. And while working in the toy industry, I was still collecting. That's my figure collection behind me at my desk. Most people had, you know, work-related things. I just had a lot of toys. Well, eventually, I was able to work for a company, in this case, Jack's Pacific, and I got to work on their Big Figs line of Star Wars product, and this was really a dream come true. I had already worked on dream jobs like Masters of the Universe, Back to the Future, and Ghostbusters. Like I said, I am an active collector, and that was something really rare in the toy industry. Most people are there to get the job done and to make product, and rightly so, and they're very smart to be doing this, and this is probably how they're able to hang on to their jobs. Me, I was always about collecting. And looking back at the time I'd spent as a kid on Star Wars, it was a brand that I really wanted the chance to work on, and that was the reason that I left Mattel and went to Jack's Pacific. It was a great opportunity to finally get to work on this brand. Now, looking back at our childhoods, Star Wars ended, in a toy sense of the word, in 1984, 1985, when the last wave of Power of the Force shipped. These were the figures that came with coins, and they were also available on tri-logo cards, meaning foreign, three-language cards. And basically, between 1977, when A New Hope hit theaters, and 1985, that was the vintage line. I mean, granted, the only toy that came out even close to 1977 was the Early Bird kit, but that's not important. A lot of people still look at the line as starting in 1977 with the movie, even though the figures really didn't hit till 1978. But, you know, that's just being technical, which we're going to hit a lot in this video series. So, fast forwarding, after the original line ended, 10 years went by, and there were very few Star Wars toys until 1995, that decade of darkness, they say, between 85 and 95, when Hasbro, which now owned Kenner, the company that put out the original toys, decided to bet big and put Star Wars out as an action figure line again without any entertainment, just based on the strength of the property. And at this point, it was basically Timothy Zahn novels and some Dark Horse comics like Dark Empire. There wasn't that much going on, and it really was a bet because Star Wars, while it was, you know, we look at it now, and it's an evergreen line, meaning it never leaves retail, but there was 10 years where there were no Star Wars toys at mass retail. I mean, there were a few things. But it was nothing like it is today where, you know, you could buy Baby Yoda on everything from cereal boxes to shoelaces. So they went big. Even their first launch wave had 9 figures, all the main characters from the first movie, which is big. Now, one thing I will say, and this has helped me both as a toy collector and as a brand manager, product designer in the toy industry, is I absolutely have a form of OCD where I put everything in order and like to track everything. And it's definitely paid off because, honestly, looking back at the last 25 years of collecting what's called the modern line, I can remember buying every single figure, where I bought it, when I bought it, how I acquired it, what I thought about. And since I've also been blessed from working in the toy industry, this series I'm going to do, which is this being the first episode, I'm going to go wave by wave and just review every line, both from a collector point of view and an industry point of view. I didn't work on them, but I actively collected them. And when these orange carded figures hit at my local Target, I was ecstatic. Well, actually, I wasn't. I was ecstatic, but I wasn't going to be all in at first. I just bought Chewbacca, and I was like, okay, I'm going to buy one figure. And then I bought Darth Vader. Okay, I bought two figures, and then R2-D2. And then suddenly I had two Stormtroopers, a Luke and a Han, and a Ben Kenobi. Leia and 3PO actually didn't ship till later, but I was definitely getting addicted very quickly and realized that I was going to be all in. Now, I wasn't collecting this for the money. I was collecting this for the enjoyment of owning Star Wars toys again and, you know, nostalgia about my childhood. But there were a lot of people who were buying these thinking they were going to get rich because vintage Star Wars toys did go for big money. And Hasbro really bet big on this too. They even went on TV advertising the basic figures, which almost never happens. You never see this kind of thing. Usually there's what's called a TV driver. Oh, look at the way the Stormtrooper is holding his gun in that image. All right, so the figures themselves, it's interesting because most toys run somewhere between 10,000 and 50,000 units, more maybe for a movie line. Well, this first wave of Star Wars figures, because of the overwhelming demand, since there'd been 10 years of nothing, this built-up demand, they ran these figures at something like 250 to 300,000 units per figure, which is insane. Like, action figure lines just don't get those kind of production numbers. And that's why you still see the original wave, the orange carded figures, selling for like $4.99 at used bookstores. They haven't increased in value one penny. You can basically get them for the $19.95 price. And while kids who grew up in the 90s were the main target for this new line, hoping that they would get into Star Wars just like kids 10 years earlier did, there was absolutely a very strong appeal to the adult collector that was just starting to emerge, thanks to things like Playmates' interest in Star Trek and aiming it at an older audience, and McFarlane Toys, which revolutionized sculpt and paint deco specifically to the adult collector. So, yeah, collectors of Star Wars worldwide looked around and were like, oh my gosh, it's back. It's been gone for 10 years, but we have Star Wars toys again.
Hey, Calculon's back!
Because pretty much before Hasbro brought it back, all you really had were things like, you know, Bendies from Just Toys. And, you know, even though they did go a little deep in the character selection, they even made Admiral Ackbar and Royal Guards in this series. This was basically the only action figure type Star Wars item you could find for 10 years. This new line wasn't just bringing Star Wars back. You know, this was a new hope. This was literally because it meant, wow, maybe Star Wars toys are going to be a big thing again. Or maybe it'll just be one wave and it'll go away. It was kind of a 50-50, and Hasbro was betting big and taking a bet on this. It was, you know, an unproven property at this point. Now, the first wave did suffer from what I call Wave 1 syndrome. You can click on the video and learn more about that, but it's basically when the first wave has a lot of issues that get changed later on. So, for example, characters like Ben Obi-Wan Kenobi, he kind of fell over a lot, like a real lot, not to mention the fact that he had like enormous C-clamp hands and the way his cloak worked, it was like a one-piece thing where his head went through. At the time, we thought this was the only Obi-Wan we were going to get. The idea that there was going to be future versions that just got better and better with time. You know, Star Wars toys had been gone so long that we were kind of grateful to get anything. Even a Stormtrooper that was kind of off-model and came with a gun that looked like it was more of like kind of a G.I. Joe sci-fi Power Ranger thing. I mean, yeah, you have got your standard Stormtrooper rifle there, but what the heck is that other giant thing he comes with? I did not see that in a movie. Not to mention that details like height and, you know, width were not quite right. I mean, Chewie and Han being the same height. You know, again, we thought this was it. This was our only Han and Chewie we were going to get. We had no idea if this line was going to take off. The fact that, you know, years later we were going to get perfect versions of the figures in every detail with holsters and bowcasters and, you know, different expressions on the face and with reissues. I mean, the line's come a long way. Probably, though, the most notorious thing about the original release, the original wave in 1995, was the fact that the figures were, well, I guess you could say athletic. I actually get this question asked a lot, why this wave had such buff sculpts and why Luke has pecs like this. I mean, of course, the vintage line, you can't even call it the vintage line, can you? Or the retro line, the original line? What do you call it with all these reissues these days? Well, the original line in the 80s was notorious for, some odd sculpt things, like, Han having different heads, or in this case, not even having a neck. But they didn't go as far as to make the figures into Superman with these giant chest muscles the way the 1995 line did. I mean, these guys were, like, not just Star Wars characters, they were action heroes. In fact, there was even a joke going around that all of the Star Wars figures had been busy during the 10 years away from shelf, working out on the Han Solo Flex. But I stayed up all night working on that one. Well, why is this? Well, if you look at figures that were at market at the same time in 1993, when this line was worked on, because it takes 2 years to get to market, all the figures at market in 1993 pretty much had this type of physique, having really buff figures with broad triangular chests and huge arms and giant fists was basically the thing to do. I mean, even that the fat guy from Seinfeld's character from Jurassic Park got a little buffed out. Well, it was sculpted before they cast him, but that's not important. The point is, everybody was buff in the toy aisle in the early 90s, and that's why Star Wars was doing that, because Hasbro felt for a kid to be into the line, they had, grown up with these movies with huge buff action stars, probably culminating in at least the iconic image is in Predator, when you have the governor of California shaking hands with the dude from Mandalorian, and there's like muscles on muscles on muscles. So yeah, muscles were big in the early 90s, coming off of the 80s. Kids wanted to be buff and, be into physical fitness. Even Schwarzenegger was working with the first president, George Bush, on a national fitness program for kids. But for collectors, this was kind of like, what the what? This is not what Luke looks like. I mean, he's not even buff. He's the opposite of that. Well, Hasbro heard fans loud and clear, but it takes a while to get a new Luke into the market. But you can tell from later releases in the Power of the Force line, which came out about 2 years later, they did correct this and make Luke's body more screen accurate. But as I've noted in other videos in the industry, it takes 2 years to go from concept to shelf, sometimes three. So yeah, it was going to be a while till a new Luke could get out there. People were going to have buff Luke for, 2 years before they could get a version closer to a screen accurate. And then there's his lightsaber. Ah, yes, the giant lightsabers that shipped with the first wave. They were eventually shrunk down to about 3/4 the size. But yeah, they all had gigantic lightsabers at first, which honestly I thought was really cool. Maybe they'll bring this back. And as I mentioned earlier in the video, Princess Leia and C-3PO weren't ready for the initial case packs. So even though they were in the wave and on the cross-sell, they didn't ship until a little bit later on. It was about 2 month gap until they started showing up at retail. And of course, you can't talk about Princess Leia in this first wave without addressing the face. And there were some issues. And yes, there were some issues with that face. Fans called it a monkey face, and they're not far off. She doesn't really look beautiful the way Carrie Fisher does and a princess should. Again, Hasbro corrected this, and it took about 2 years. In fact, I think she shipped in the same corrected wave as that new Luke. And it just, shows from reaction to getting a correction at market takes 2 years, and that's a perfect example. This wave did ship with some vehicles as well. I mean, they made a splash on shelf with all of the needed price points to fill out a planogram, including the Millennium Falcon on the bottom shelf, which is amazing that they still had the tools from the originals. That's unbelievable that they lasted these 10 years. I heard actually the Millennium Falcon tool was dropped on the floor about 10 years ago and cracked in half. Well, people did think this line was only going to be out for a limited time. The idea that it was going to go on to become the powerhouse it is was, just a dream. I'm sure glad it has, and there's been a lot of figures released since then, and I'm going to hit them all, at least all the original trilogy ones, because that's my piece of cake. While I love the prequels and the sequels are okay, I'm an original trilogy guy, and that's what I collect and that's what I obsess over. So we're going to hit that in the series. If you are up for it, let me know what you think. Should I keep going with this? Leave your comments below, and a subscription and a like is also helpful because it tells YouTube to share this with other people. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Wave 2, Lando's coming. Boba Fett 2. And Yoda.